Hello everybody, this is Dr. Indrani Deb, Principal Nistarini College, Purulia, West Bengal. Today I am going to speak about Ionesco's Rhinoceros as a political drama. If you like the lecture, please like and subscribe to the channel. Ionesco's Rhinoceros is essentially political drama, but this political argument has been presented in the form of what has been termed absurdist drama or theatre of the absurd. As such, we shall begin by defining this genre. Absurdism focuses mainly on the existentialist idea of a meaningless, absurd world. All absurdist drama was intensely influenced by existentialist philosophers like Camus or Sartre. Soren Kierkegaard is generally considered to be the first existentialist philosopher, though the term existentialism came into use much later. All existentialists see the world as confusing and disorienting, and humanity is shown to be struggling vainly to find a purpose in life and to control his fate. Kierkegaard suggested that each individual is solely responsible for giving meaning to life and to live life sincerely and authentically. Existentialism is also often connected with Nietzsche's nihilism, for Nietzsche is an important philosopher in both philosophies. The combining of the two is called existential nihilism, which argues that life is without objective, meaning, or purpose. Nihilists also maintain that morality does not exist at all and reality itself is non-existent. The existentialist angst is a term that refers to the sense of confusion or disorientation that arises from the realization of such a world. The existentialist idea that existence precedes essence is often brought into the sphere of analysis. Jean-Paul Sartre said that humans have no essence before their existence because there is no creator. As one cannot explain one's actions and behavior by reference to a specific human nature, humans are therefore totally responsible for their actions. As he said, we are left alone without excuse, and also that we can act without being determined by our past, which is always separated from us. We have to experience death consciousness in order to wake up to what is really important. Death emphasizes the burden of our free individual existence. This is, in fact, somewhat different from nihilism because it is only rarely that existentialist philosophers ignore morality. Therefore, absurdist drama deals with a condition in which all meaning in life and normal human communication breaks down. Much of the dialogue in absurdist drama is naturalistic, but there are moments in which the characters use nonsense language or cliches or repeat certain words or lines continuously. Often nonsense language is used to denote that language is breaking down or to show the limits of language. Sometimes language is given a rhythmical, musical quality to make it different from ordinary speech. Much of absurdist drama is political, avant-garde theatre. The term avant-garde means advance guard or vanguard, to denote works that are experimental, radical, or unorthodox. This kind of art began in the late 19th century and in the 20th century became the hallmark of modernism as distinct from postmodernism. In many cases, avant-garde literature was politically motivated and had a definite political message, particularly left-oriented message. We come to the characteristics of absurdist drama. We may, with the help of a diagram, give a short summary of the characteristics of absurdist drama, as this was the medium through which these dramatists expressed their view of the world. The first point is that it shows an incomprehensible world. All the absurdist plays focus on human beings trapped in an incomprehensible world, and they are subjected to illogical occurrences. Realistic incidents are consciously avoided and characters are not developed in the traditional manner. We shall come to the characters presently. The second point is sense in nonsense. Theatre of the absurd may seem to be nonsensical on the surface, but it always has something to say and can be understood on a deeper level. According to Martin Eslin, the author of the book The Theatre of the Absurd, I'm quoting from him, "Absurdism is the inevitable devaluation of ideals, purity, or purpose." He also says, "Absurd is that which is devoid of purpose. Cut off from his religion, metaphysics, and transcendental roots, man is lost. All his actions become senseless, absurd, useless." The third point is the characters, stereotyped characters. The characters of absurdist drama are all stuck in an incomprehensible universe, as we have mentioned earlier. Rational thought and discursive dialogue are abandoned. Many characters seem like automatons, stuck in routines and speaking in cliches. The characters are stereotyped, as in Commedia dell'arte. There are one or two complex characters, but they are unable to make sense of the world around them, which seems chaotic, abandoned by science and logic. In Rhinoceros, for example, Berenger remains the only human being in a world peopled with rhinoceroses, and he has to decide whether to conform or not. The fourth point that we come to is a non-naturalistic language. The illogical world reflects itself in irrational speech, which has lost the capacity for logical construction and argument. Silence is often used with great effect, as in Beckett's Waiting for Godot. The final point is the absurd plot. In absurdist drama, traditional plot structures are mostly abandoned, and often the plot consists of absurd repetitions of cliches and routines, as in Godot, or the bald prima donna, Ionesco's prima donna. Absence, emptiness, and nothingness are used to great effect, as in Waiting for Godot. the plot centers on the absence of a man called Godo. Rhinoceros stands on repetitions in dialogue and scenes. For example, the rooms of Berenger are almost exactly the same as those of his friend Jean. Often the plot may revolve around an unexplained metamorphosis or supernatural change, as happens in Rhinoceros. In Ionesco's Amédée, a couple has to deal with a corpse that is steadily growing larger and larger. But Ionesco never fully reveals the identity of the corpse, how the person died, or why it is growing. Ultimately, without any explanation, it floats away. Eugene Ionesco's dates are 1909 to 1994. We come to this dramatist, who is one of the foremost dramatists writing in the absurdist form. He was a Romanian-French playwright and wrote mainly in French. He was one of the foremost writers of the French avant-garde theatre. His first play, written in 1948, was La Cantatrice Chauvet, or The Bald Prima Donna. Other plays that he wrote include The Chairs, The Lesson, The New Tenant, The Kitten, The Killer, Amédée, and The Rhinoceros. It was Martin Eslin who first included him among the writers of absurdist drama in his book, The Theatre of the Absurd. In the early part of his career, he wrote one-act absurdist sketches, which he called anti-play, to indicate that they were different from bourgeois drama. In his anti-plays, Ionesco rejects a conventional storyline and coherent dialogue, thereby depicting a dehumanized world where feelings of alienation are emphasized. Ionesco's Rhinoceros has been specifically included in Martin Eslin's study of post-war absurdist theater. According to Eslin, Samuel Beckett and Ionesco better captured the meaninglessness of existence than even Albert Camus or Jean-Paul Sartre, who are well-known existentialist writers. The play is set in a small provincial town in which nothing normally happens. Suddenly, all the people begin turning into rhinoceroses except the protagonist, Berenger, who is shown as a laid-back drunkard. The play contains all the elements of absurdist drama, including an absurd plot, an existentialist theme, stereotyped characters, and non-naturalistic language. Berenger is probably a prototype of the author himself. Even the writer acknowledged a similarity between himself and Berenger, who appears in four of Ionesco's plays. The four plays are Rhinoceros, The Killer, Exit the King, and A Stroll in the Air. Like Ionesco, Berenger is a political rebel who refuses to submit to fascist authority and vows to fight the power of rhinoceroses, who represent submission to fascism, till the end. To understand the political theme of the play Rhinoceros, we have to go back to the political history of Romania in the period between the wars. Ionesco's father was Romanian and belonged to the Orthodox Church, but his mother was French-Romanian and had Jewish ancestry. There was an increasing anti-Semitist atmosphere in Romania in the interwar era. Even being partly Jewish was enough to put Ionescu in danger. The Romanian radical right claimed that Jews were illegal immigrants from Poland, as most Romanian Jews were descendants of Ashkenazi Jews who had moved to Romania from Poland. Students were also accusing Jews of appropriating jobs. This was one of the major reasons of the student community becoming anti-Semitist. The Fascist Iron Guard was founded in 1927 by Corneliu Zilia Codriani. The most virulent and violent anti-Semitic movement was unleashed by this Iron Guard or Legion. As a university student, Ionescu saw one of his professors, Nae Ionescu, use his lectures to recruit students into the Legion. In fact, Romanian university students were highly represented in the Legion. In an interview in 1970, Ionescu said that the message of the play Rhinoceros is an attack on those Romanians who joined the ideological contagion of the Legion. The words ideological contagion are Ionescu's own. The Legion called to end the Jewish colonization of Romania by expelling all the Jews and confiscating their assets. This idea was extremely attractive to university students. Codrianu called for a Romania without individualism, where all Romanians would be united together as one. This meant a wiping away of individualism, but it appealed to the younger generation. They believed that when Codrianu was able to create his new man or Omul Nou, a new utopian society would come into existence in Romania. Ionescu, however, could not support this and felt that the abandonment of the French idea of universal human rights in favor of the death cult of the Legion was a betrayal. He felt more and more out of place while he clung to his humanistic values, and all his friends joined the Legion. Therefore, all intellectuals were turning Nazi, while only Ionescu remained humanist alone. It is much like the predicament of Berenger at the end of Rhinoceros. He remains the last human being in a world overrun by rhinoceroses. Let us take the play act by act. We come to act one of the play. The main incidents of this act in order of occurrence are: first, Jean advises his friend Berenger, who is an alcoholic, to change his lifestyle. Secondly, the logician and the old man discuss logic and come to entirely illogical conclusions. Thirdly, the first rhinoceros appears. The people are more concerned about how many horns it has. Fourthly, there is also the hint that Berenger is attracted to Daisy, a typist in his office. And fifth, the second rhinoceros appears and kills a cat. The political ramifications of Act 1. We shall take each of the incidents mentioned just now for analysis. The dialogues between Berenger and his friend Jean are important, because they bring out two different attitudes and philosophical ideals. Ja emphasizes willpower and says, the superior man is the man who fulfills his duty. This idea of the superior man is taken from Friedrich Nietzsche's vision of the Superman, who is beyond conventional human morality, as he is marked to rule the world. In fact, Hitler exploited and abused Nietzsche's ideas heavily in convincing the Germans that the Aryans were a master race, which was destined to control the world. Ja is also steeped in logic, and as such, cannot at first accept the presence of a rhinoceros in the town. He shouts, "It shouldn't be allowed." To him, dreaming too is not part of his duty. As he says, there's no difference between dreaming awake and dreaming asleep. He tries to find a logical reason for the presence of the rhinoceros. Berenger, however, breaks logic at every point. "I do dream," he says. "Life is a dream." To him, the rhino does not exist at all. "We are not going to bother about some animal that does not exist," he says. In the same way, when Ja talks of doing his duty, all he can say is, "What duty?" He drinks because alcohol is the only means of escape from the collective psychosis into which everyone falls. "It calms me down and relaxes me so I can forget," he says about alcohol. He is always tired of life and tries to find a means of escape. Ja also tells Berenger, "You don't exist, my dear Berenger, because you don't think. Start thinking, then you will." This is directly connected with the well-known philosophical premise of Descartes, "I think, therefore I am." For Descartes, the ability to think is the only proof of existence, something which in turn is related to the existentialist idea that existence precedes essence. To Berenger, however, true existence is related to a commitment to something significant. The second important and consecutive dialogue in the first act is that between the logician and the old man. Here, logic is shown as something that is absurd and inexplicable, and the very foundations of logic is parodied. The logician is a master of syllogism, and he is shown to take syllogisms to ridiculous extremes of false logic. By the way, let me explain, a syllogism is a form of deductive logic where a conclusion is drawn from two given propositions in which there is a common or middle term. For example, man is mortal, Ram is a man, and therefore Ram is mortal. There is, however, every scope of taking syllogisms to illogical extremes. An absurdist play, in essence, breaks logicality. As such, Ionesco uses the logician as a butt of satire. One of the first examples of syllogisms given by the logician is itself illogical. He says, "All cats die, Socrates is dead, therefore Socrates is a cat." The point is that whatever the logician says, he is unable to clarify an absurd world. His ridiculous inversions are an example of reductio ad absurdum, that is, pushing logic to absurd and contradictory levels. The height of absurdity is reached when the logician proves to the old gentleman that a dog is a cat because it has four paws. The logician uses the tenets of logic to reach illogical ends, but the play continuously shows commonly logical people behaving absurdly. Then we have the appearance of the first rhinoceros. This rhino is introduced in a subtle way, and even though its presence is absurd in a small town, the people make inane remarks like, "Well, of all things," and "Oh, a rhino." Berenger is so apathetic that he hardly notices it, and later tries to account for it to Jean with bored comments like, "Perhaps it escaped from a zoo." What is important is that the success of the Iron Guard under Codriano was affected in part by the collective consciousness of the people, whereby all the people have a tendency to follow the same path if they are emotionally convinced of it. Carl Jung had established this notion as an inherent tendency in humanity. The seeds of collective consciousness is shown in this scene by Ionesco through dialogue devices of repetitive exclamations and similar remarks by all the people. Even two sets of dialogues, those between Jean and Berenger and between the logician and the old man, are carried on simultaneously and using the same kind of language. Meanwhile, we have Berenger's attraction to Daisy, a typist in Berenger's office. It is only in her presence that he becomes conscious of his bedraggled appearance. Jean notices this and points out that, however much Berenger protests about not caring for anything, he does care about one thing, Daisy. Then the second rhino appears, and both Berenger and Daisy see it, along with the others. What is different about the rhino this time is that it kills a cat. In this respect, this is a pointer to the escalation of violence and its relation to fascism. In the case of the first rhino, nobody was much bothered about it because it did nobody any harm. But this time, a cat is trampled. In theory, this is a reference to John Stuart Mill's harm principle in his essay on liberty, according to which individual freedom should be preserved at all costs unless it harms someone else. Ionesco is as if suggesting that as long as fascism is harmless, it can be ignored. But as soon as it begins to violate the harm principle, which it will inevitably do, it has to be rooted out. The other important point here is the reactions of the people. Instead of discussing the seriousness of not one, but two rhinoceroses trampling over the town, they seem to be more concerned with whether the rhino has one or two horns, and whether the one or two horned rhinos are African or Asiatic animals, and also about which of them is superior. This is obviously a satire on racism. Jean judges superiority by the number of horns of the rhino, making him a caricature of those people who judge people by the color of their skins. In Romania, a recurring theme in Nazi propaganda was that Jews were originally an Asiatic people who illegally settled in Europe. Ra's opinions angers Berenger, who calls them nonsense, and a quarrel breaks out between them, where Ra's racist intentions become clear when he calls Berenger an Asiatic Mongol. Berenger says, "Asiatics are people the same as we are." And Ra says, "They are yellow," another reference to skin color. We come to Act 2, Scene 1. Act 2 has two scenes. The first scene is set in the private law office in which Berenger works. He is late as usual, but Daisy quickly makes him sign before she puts away the timesheets. The easy relationship between Berenger and Daisy is very evident in this scene, though we would stop short of calling it a love relation. Here, we also meet Botard, the skeptic, who does not believe in rhinos appearing on the streets of the town. He accuses Berenger of inventing this. Later, Mrs. Boerf comes in search of her husband. After some time, she realizes that her husband has become a rhinoceros. She goes away riding on his back. Now, after having seen a rhino with his own eyes, Botard regards rhinoceroses as traitors. Finally, at the end of the scene, firemen rescue them from the office. The political ramifications of Act 2, Scene 1. In the beginning of the scene, we are given a glimpse of the private law office in which Berenger works. The dreary environment is condemned by Ionesco from the very beginning. There is a petty rivalry between Berenger and Dudar for Daisy's attentions, and there is a petty competition between Botard and Dudar for the good graces of Papillon, the office manager. The gossip going on is shallow, and the people are treated no better than office hands and not as human beings. All this explains the alienating influence of the office on Berenger and partly suggests a reason for his turning to drink for survival. The focus is on Botard, the skeptic, from the beginning of the scene. He mocks at the news of rhinoceroses on the streets of the town and finds opportunities to put in comments that are ostensibly progressive and anti-fascist. For example, he refers to the cat trampled by a pachyderm and asks what color the cat was. "The color bar is something I feel strongly about," he says. "I hate it." And again he says, "But you can't deny that the color problem is one of the great stumbling blocks of our time." When Berenger comes in and asserts that the rhinos are real and that he has seen them and that Daisy too has seen them, Botard directly accuses him of lies and propaganda. He says, "You've been making all this propaganda to get all these rumors started." The word propaganda itself is politically oriented. This idea is increased when Dudad, angry at Botard's mockery, accuses him of being in the pay of a furtive underground organization, which Botard of course takes as an insult. Botard also speaks of collective psychosis in relation to the rhinoceroses. This actually refers to one of the major themes of the play. The fact that all his acquaintances assert the presence of the rhino is taken by him to be an example of collective psychosis that is in turn related to Jung's theory of the collective unconscious. It is this human tendency that was used by the Nazis and by Quadriano in collecting support from the people. Bothard also adds that it is like religion, the opiate of the people. I repeat, like religion, the opiate of the people, which is a reference to the Marxist belief that religion is the opium of the masses. However, though Bothard seems highly anti-fascist here, the hypocrisy of his beliefs will be exposed soon. That is why Bothard becomes a satire on the Romanian intelligentsia like Jean Berenger's friend. The character of the intelligentsia was that they are ostensibly progressive, but they follow Quadriano's iron guard as soon as it promises to banish Jews. Here, however, Bothard pompously discourses on the need for reason and practical thinking. He says, there's no clear thinking at the universities, no encouragement for practical observation. In the middle of all these debates, Mrs. Boeuf enters looking for her husband, but is also scared because she says she is escaping from a rhinoceros, which is at the moment attempting to come upstairs. Its attempts result in the staircase collapsing, while the employees again begin the debate on the number of horns it has. Mrs. Boeuf suddenly realizes that the rhinoceros is her own husband transformed in this way. Actually, Mr. Boeuf's transformation is the first metamorphosis that is not anonymous, and is also the first humanizing of the animal. For Mr. Boeuf's tender trumpeting to his wife is stressed. The play Rhinoceros is generally viewed as an indictment of man's intrinsic savagery and his latent capacity for evil. But in Mr. Boeuf's case, the savagery of his onlookers becomes more prominent than that of the rhino itself. We also find the same tenderness in Mrs. Boeuf when she chooses to follow her husband instead of avoiding him. The reactions of the employees of the firm, however, become interesting. Mr. Papillon threatens to fire Mr. Boeuf for becoming a rhino and not sending in any notice for leave. And this increases the absurdity of the entire incident. The fact that he regards Mr. Boeuf as a mere hand in the mill is shown when he remarks, "It means one employee less who has to be replaced." Mr. Papillon, therefore, becomes a caricature of a capitalist, just as Jean and Bothard are caricatures of intellectuals. Bothard, of course, now has to acknowledge the rhino, and he strongly denies that he ever denied it before. Like Jean, he rationalizes his inconsistent behavior. "I know my own mind," he says. "I am not content to simply state that a phenomenon exists. I make it my business to understand and explain it." The irony is that his understanding at this point makes him brand those who have transformed into rhinos as traitors. He says, "I also know the names of those responsible, the names of the traitors. You can't fool me. I'll let you know the purpose and meaning of this whole plot. I'll unmask the perpetrators." Later, after the rhinos become the majority and Berenger is the only human left, then Berenger becomes the traitor. What is to be noticed is that Berenger remains passive and uninvolved in this entire scene. He does not vehemently contradict anybody, even Botad, and at the end, he is visibly sorry that he has alienated Jean and decides to go and make it up to him. This passivity makes him his later energy all the more conspicuous. Act 2, Scene 2. To make up to Jean, Berenger makes his way to Jean's apartment in this scene. Before entering Jean's apartment, Berenger meets an old man who is also called Jean. This Jean shows him which apartment to go to. The highlight of this scene is Jean's gradual transformation into a rhinoceros. So far, the rhinos had not been shown on the stage. For the first time, we see the various stages in which a human being is transformed into a rhino. In everything that Jean says and does, it is evident that he welcomes this transformation. At the end of the metamorphosis, Jean shows a definite tendency towards violence. "I'll trample you down," he shouts. Berenger tries to escape, but whichever way he goes, he sees more and more rhinoceroses. Indeed, a whole herd of them, making him remark, "And they always said the rhinoceros was a solitary animal. That's not true. That's a conception they'll have to revise." Finally, he manages to flee, shouting, "Rhinoceros! Rhinoceros!" When we analyze these incidents, we find a definite political undertone in each of them. For instance, at the beginning of the scene, it is a coincidence that both men in the apartment block are called Jean. This is further evidence of collective consciousness, in that individuality becomes blurred. Secondly, throughout Jean's transformation into a rhino, his speeches show a gradual turning towards fascist ideals. For example, he tells Berenger, "I never dream," which is in sharp contrast to Berenger in Act 1, who wondered whether life was a dream. Jean says, "I'm master of my own thoughts. My mind doesn't wander. I think straight. I always think straight." This is Ionesco mocking that free will. Jean thinks that he is master of his thoughts, but all the time he's submitting to the collective consciousness manipulated by the fascist leaders. The more he turns into a rhino, the more he thinks that he is perfectly healthy and his nervous system is in perfect order. This is a reference to people believing that it is quite natural to join the Iron Guard and unnatural not to do so. That is why he remarks, "They invent illnesses." Another extremely fascist statement that he makes is, "It's not that I hate people, I'm just indifferent to them, or rather, they disgust me, and they'd better keep out of my way, or I'll run them down." It is typically fascist to eliminate these people who do not agree with the philosophy of hatred that is characteristic of them. Jean also makes it clear that his turning into a rhino is done voluntarily, on purpose, and is therefore, again, a matter of free will. He refers to Boaz's transformation and says that he is all the better for it, for becoming a rhino. On the other hand, all Berenger's speeches show a contrast to Jean's point of view. For example, there is an animated debate between Berenger and Jean regarding nature and morality, which is regarded as a human, the morality is regarded as a human violation of nature by Jean. Berenger says that humans have moral standards which are incompatible with those of animals, to which Jean exclaims, "I am sick of moral standards. We need to go beyond moral standards." Berenger asks, what would you put in their place? Jean answers, nature. Because, he again says, nature has its own laws. Morality is against nature. This again is an assertion of the Nietzschean idea of the Superman, who has the right to circumvent morality and therefore gain power. Berenger is shocked. Are you suggesting we replace our moral laws by those of the jungle? Jean says, it would suit me fine. The point is that the more Jean transforms into a rhino, the more his attitude tends towards violence. He talks of demolishing all the values and philosophy of humankind. He talks of demolishing the idea of clothes. He talks of trampling down Berenger. And finally, his horn does pierce Berenger's clothes, missing him narrowly, showing fascism's inevitable turn towards violence. It is then that Berenger decides to run. But whichever way he tries to escape, he sees hordes of rhinos bearing down on him, and finally he escapes through the back wall, shouting, "Rhinoceros, rhinoceros!" Act 3. The third act is set in Berenger's room, which is almost the same as Jean's room in the previous scene. Berenger is terrified of becoming a rhino, showing that becoming a rhino is more or less voluntary. Presently, Dudad enters and there is a long conversation in which Dudad tries to reason with him. Dudad also gives the news that Papillon, the office manager, has become a rhinoceros. Berenger is unable to believe this. Next, Daisy enters and gives the news that Botard too has become a rhino. This too Berenger cannot believe. Dudad leaves them to become a rhino. Berenger and Daisy are alone, and there is a beautiful love scene between them. Berenger and Daisy, however, soon disagree on Berenger's plan to regenerate the human race, and Daisy leaves Berenger. Berenger remains the only human being left there. When we analyze these events, we find that in the beginning of the scene, Berenger is paranoid about becoming a rhino. He has even bandaged his forehead for fear horns will sprout there. After Dudad enters, this criterion of voluntary submission is discussed between them. Dudad says that he sees no bump on Berenger's forehead, and Berenger passionately says, "I hope there never will be, never." Dudad says, "If you don't knock yourself, why should there be?" Berenger's reply is important. "If you really don't want to knock yourself, you don't." The wanting is necessary to be able to transform. Later, Buddha tells him to exercise willpower to counter the collective consciousness. He says, I remember you said yourself that the best protection against the thing was willpower. Berenja insists that he does everything deliberately, even drinking. Berenja continuously talks of Jean's transformation and sees it as a kind of betrayal. He says that Jean was the last person he had expected to change like that in front of him, and thinks that Jean should have controlled himself. What is important here is the connection with Romanian politics. When all the university students were going in hordes to join Codrianu's Iron Guard, Ionescu too saw it as a betrayal, for he had had faith in the intellectuals among whom he himself belonged. In the 1930s, Ionescu became more and more alienated as all his friends joined the Legion, and he felt very much like Berenja does at the end, the last human who is clinging to humanistic values. Dudad expresses the view that the transformation was a kind of disease, and Berenja calls it rhinoceritis. In the play, rhinoceritis becomes a metaphor for fascism. Berenja tries to make sense out of the nonsense by opting to believe that rhinoceritis can be cured like a disease, and therefore Jean and the others will see reason soon and can be cured. There is a definite conflict of ideas in Berenja's and Dudad's opinions regarding the rhino, representing the two conflicting ideologies of fascism and humanism. For instance, there is a recurrence of John Stuart Mill's harm principle again. When Dudad tells Berenja, they are not doing you any harm. Berenja, however, is convinced that they are evil, the rhinos are evil. We must attack the evil at the roots, he says. Dudad vehemently differs. The evil, that's just a phrase. Who knows what is evil and what is good? That is what he says. Who knows what is evil and what is good? He also does not agree that the metamorphosis is abnormal. Who can say, he says again, who can say where the normal stops and the abnormal begins? Dudad tells Berenja critically, you'll never become a rhinoceros. You haven't got the vocation. Again, the point of voluntary submission comes in. To assert that Berenja does not have the vocation is to say that he lacks the will to attain the powerful status of the rhinoceros. The irony is that Berenja too changes at the end, but this metamorphosis is from an apathetic, indifferent person to a strong, free-willed person. And this is a completely different kind of change than the change to a rhinoceros. Very soon, Berenja hears that Papillon has become a rhino, and he is astonished because Papillon had a very good job to live for, a strange idea for one who is completely disgusted with his workplace. Berenja, however, admits that this transformation would never have occurred if Papillon did not have any hidden complexes. The important point is that Dudad reports that Botad was incensed and indignant at Papillon's transformation, which is ironical, seeing that Botad will soon be transformed into a rhinoceros himself. On the other hand, Dudad thinks that Berenja is intolerant because he cannot accept Papillon's transformation. He says it was his duty not to succumb. Dudad refuses to accept that the whole process is absurd. Everything is logical, he says. To understand is to justify. Berenger sees the symptoms of becoming a rhino immediately. He says, you'll be siding with the rhinoceroses before long. And he is right. What could be more natural than a rhinoceros? Dudad says. Berenger thinks it is abnormal because his leanings are humanistic. Dudad is doubly convinced that he is right when he sees that the logician also has become a rhinoceros. He must have weighed all the pros and cons before deciding. This is to him very important, the logician also becoming a rhinoceros. While they are arguing like this, Daisy enters and Dudad is not happy at all. He begins making snide remarks about her relationship with Berenger, even though they insist on his staying and joining them in a meal. Dudad insists that he will not inflict himself on Berenger and Daisy and would have left immediately had not Daisy given the news that Botad had transformed into a rhinoceros. This is an absolute shock to Berenger, who tries to find a logical answer to this riddle. He tries to justify Botad's transformation by saying that it was a disguise. Not aware that the true disguise had been the human skin that had been hiding the savagery of these creatures all along. But Dudad realizes that though now the rhinos are in the minority, they will not remain so for long, and he decides to join up with them. It is the wisest course to take, he says. I prefer the great universal family to the little domestic one. Quadrianu had been telling everyone that it is their duty to join him. And Dudad now says, it's my duty to stick by them. I have to do my duty. Though, of course, Berenger tells him that it is his duty to oppose the rhinos. Berenger and Daisy are tremendously hurt when Dudad goes away to join the rhinos, for they insist that he is normal and too good-hearted. Berenger looks out of the door to call Dudad back. He goes out many times. He tries to call him back many times. And he finds crowds of rhinoceroses marching down the street, all looking exactly alike. He recognizes the collective consciousness here, for there is no difference in them except for the fact that some have one horn and some have two. After the departure of Dudad, Berenger and Daisy express their love for each other. They envisage a utopian life together, and Berenger is constantly conscious that this life will be a complete contrast with that of the rhinoceroses. Even Daisy's beauty is different from the ugliness of the rhinos. He says that he will protect her, though Daisy thinks that she does not need protecting. She says, we don't wish anyone any harm, and no one wishes us any harm. Berenger replies, sometimes one does harm without meaning to. And this is Ionesco's final critique of John Stuart Mill's harm principle. And Ionesco wanted to show that seemingly harmless action can lead to violence and harm. Even remaining passive like Berenger can cause harm. Berenger is a realist, and Daisy cannot accept this. Where's your imagination, she says. Escape into the world of the imagination. And this is what Berenger is unable to do. Daisy wants an insulated world. Beringer wants to save humanity. Daisy says, we even owe ourselves a duty to be happy in spite of everything. Guilt is a dangerous symptom. It shows lack of purity. In fact, we find that love and guilt are the dominant emotions at the end of the play. And Beringer's and Daisy's ideas regarding these emotions are in conflict with each other. Daisy seeks a happy, guiltless life, but it is detached from humanity, and her love for Beringer is love for an individual and not for humanity. As Beringer says, happiness is such an egotistical thing. Beringer at first he accepts Daisy's dream of a guiltless life. However, this does not last, and his love encompasses all of humanity. This is also the reason why Beringer remains human and Daisy leaves to join the rhinos, who are selfish in their concern for themselves. Beringer says, the world is sick. They are all sick. Daisy says, we shan't be the ones to cure them. Beringer wishes to have children to regenerate the human race. Daisy does not want children as it is a bore. Then Daisy suddenly thinks that the rhinos are the real people. They look natural, she says. They were right to do what they did. She realizes that the rhinos are the happy ones. She then feels that love is a morbid feeling and a male weakness, and the noise of the rhinos seems to be musical to her ears. Soon she realizes that, she says, it is no longer possible for us to live together. Beringer is alone at the end and wonders whether the change to being a rhinoceros is irreversible. Everything leads up at the end to Beringer's transformation into a true Superman, who is committed to humanism and concern for others. This transformation is the true metamorphosis, as opposed to the brutal metamorphosis into a rhinoceros. All the other characters physically change into rhinos, embodying the savage or selfish notions that had been repressed in them. Beringer's change is a moral change. In the last line of the play, he overturns his weak will and escapism into alcohol by deciding to save humanity against the tyranny of the rhinoceroses. His final and heroic stand is, I'm not capitulating. It is the will of responsibility, not the will of power. This is how he decides to alone stand up against the power of fascism, just as Ionesco himself had decided to do. Thank you for your patience.